Good morning, church, and welcome to worship. I am Pastor Daniel Gomez, Associate Pastor. We are glad you are here in person, but we're also glad for those of you that are joining us online. We appreciate that you take the time and you make the effort to join us, especially those of you that log in and let us know that you are watching, joining us online. We appreciate that. We pray and we hope that you will be impacted by the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place today. If this is your first time with us, it's important for you to meet a member of our staff who can help you find what you need and get you connected. Jenny?
Thank you, Pastor Daniel. Good morning. My name is Jenny, and I am the Ministry Assistant for Connections here at Shepherd of the Hills. That just means that I get to help you feel connected, welcome, and supported within our community. I'm so glad that each of you has joined us this morning. If you're new, we're especially glad that you're here, and we hope that you will feel right at home. I'd like to invite you to stop by the Welcome Center in the back, just out the doors here, for one of these gift bags that we have for you. We've prepared this just as a thank you for being with us, and we hope we'll serve as a reminder of your time with us today. I'll be back there after service, so come by and say hi, introduce yourself, ask me any questions that you might have, and if you want a name tag, you can talk to me about that as well. For all of you joining us online, good morning. We're so happy that you're with us. Our community isn't the same without you, and so we just thank you for taking the time to be with us this morning. If you haven't already done so, please fill out our connections card. They do look a little bit different, but this is your way to let us know that you were here today, and this is how we stay connected with you, the information you provide to us. So this is important, and we always appreciate when you fill these out. During our Choosing Well series, we're continuing to dive into the fruit of the Spirit, and each week we will add fruit to a digital fruit tree, like the one behind me, and we're going to populate that fruit tree with your experiences. So this week, we're reflecting on patience. If you've shown patience, received patience, or saw somebody else this week, go ahead and raise your hand so we can populate that tree. Each week, we will focus on a different fruit, so continue to share that information with us by raising your hand, but also by filling out the connection card on the back under the prayer request section. You can let us know your experiences, and we are so excited to read those each week. We've even started sharing them on the back of the flyer in your announcements. Each week, Luna and I will be making a short video on Facebook of the experiences that we're having, and we hope that you will join us in doing that, posting to Facebook as well. This week, the flyer is Choosing Kindness and Goodness, so please reference this for any inspiration you might need on how to do that this week. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Jenny. Our prayer is always that you find the things you need as we come to worship together. We don't know what that is, but you do, and God does. What is it that is troubling you? What is it that is just a burden, perhaps, on your soul, on your spirit, on your heart? Trust and believe that in this place, the Holy Spirit is already here and already knows each and every thought that we have and each and every need that we may come with. God already knows, and God invites us throughout the process of the order of worship, whether it be someone speaking like me right now, or sharing the liturgy, or doing the opening prayer, or even the choir as it's singing, and even through the sermon. God has a way of using all those components to be able to speak to our need, but more importantly, to encourage our soul, to uplift our spirit, to comfort, and to give us a way. Trust and believe on that. We begin each service by reminding ourselves what God thinks of us. From the first chapter of Ephesians, I invite you to remind yourselves, I am chosen. I am blessed.
I am love.
As you are comfortable, stand and smile at someone near you as you remind them, you are chosen. You are blessed. You are loved. Since you are already standing, take a moment to greet those around you. And now I invite us to turn toward that camera over there so we can assure our online audience, you are chosen. You are blessed. You are loved. Amen. Please be seated. Let us prepare for worship with our prelude.
Good morning. I am Mike Moore, liturgist for today. Please rise as you are comfortable for the call to worship. Throughout the ages, disciples have said, I will follow you wherever you go.
Lord, give us the freedom to follow you in the ways of love.
We come from busy homes, filled with little time to consider Christ in our lives.
Lord, give us strength to follow you in the ways of peace.
In times of struggle, we look to God.
Lord, give us patience to follow you in the ways of kindness.
Today we celebrate the Holy Spirit, who shows us the joy of following God.
Lord, give us the joy to follow you in the name of
faith. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to church. I'm Ken Goodenberger, and it's so good to be in worship with you this morning. Let's remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Thank you.
Good morning. I am Pastor Ron Friesen, Assistant Minister of Care. Please remain standing as you're comfortable and join me in the opening prayer, which will be on the screen. Holy One, we come before you today, full of hope, full of desire, full of promise. Help us take up the mantle of faith you have laid before us, that we may use our own gifts of the Spirit to face the challenges before us. Help us face the turmoil within and around us, that we may face the future unafraid. We pray that this day you will fill us with yourself and cause your fruit to ripen in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Amen. Please be seated.
The scripture lesson today is from Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 through 26. It can be found in the New Testament section of your Pew Bible on page 191 and will also be on the screen. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passion and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Let us not become conceited or provoke one another or be jealous of one another. The Word of God for the people of God.
Tell me why.
continue in our sermon series, Choosing Well. Choose kindness and goodness will be the theme for this Sunday, this morning. Chapter 5 of Galatians begins with Paul drawing a quite specific conclusion from his previous four chapters of discourse. The Galatians should not be forced to submit to circumcision. The Judaizers' insistence that this ritual be observed, Paul contends, flies in the face of Christian freedom. Clarifying the scope of this freedom is what directs and informs the rest of Paul's epistle to the Galatians. The whole of Galatians forms a coherent, progressive argument by Paul against the influences of a group of law-oriented Judaizers. They were teachers who insisted that Christians were obligated to keep the Mosaic law. While theologically rich in their own right, the first four chapters of Galatians are really a series of examples and citations about the law and the gospel leading up to the climax of Paul's arguments in chapters 5 and 6. The negative examples and fierce arguments Paul had leveled against the Judaizers, who had apparently gained considerable influence over the Galatian Christians, now gives way to Paul's positive concluding remarks. Paul counters that Christ's gift to all his disciples is true freedom. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, Paul affirms this freedom as a deliverance from the yoke of slavery. The first example Paul uses to demonstrate this freedom is discussed in chapter 5 of Galatians from verses 2 to verse 12. His testimony that circumcision gives no special standing to those who are truly seeking Christ. Obedience to that particular law is now a matter of indifference. What does matter, Paul declares, is faith working through love. But having identified freedom as Christ's gift to his followers, Paul now carefully defines just what kind of freedom this is and what it requires. Paul reveals that freedom in Christ is not a freedom toward the self-indulgence or the biblical term, get ready for this word, licentiousness. In the Bible, the word licentiousness is defined as a lack of moral restraint or disregard for accepted moral standards. Licentiousness or lewdness is not a sin of weakness, but one of willful disobedience. Licentious people do things that are really wild. Some look upon God's grace and kindness as an excuse to sin, saying, in effect, that his kindness does away with law, so we are free to do as we please. In verses 13 and 14, Paul directs the attention of his Galatian audience out of their self-absorption and reminds them that loving service is measured by one's response to the neighbor, not the self. Love, as demonstrated through service to others, is the fruit of Christian freedom. For Paul, fleshly experience, fleshly existence, was something all people were trapped in until the events of Christ's death and resurrection. Those who hear and believe the news of Christ's resurrection, however, now enter into a plane of existence, living in the Spirit. Thus, when Paul argues against being in the flesh, he is not simply citing flesh as an inferior human condition. but as a past standard that has been overwhelmed by the event of Christ's death and his resurrection. Those still in the flesh are the Judaizers whose teachings are causing a great deal of confusion and dissension in the Galatian church. Those in the spirit are all those who live the light of Christ's redemptive acts. To live in the spirit is to experience the crucifixion of one's own self, and thus to enjoy the new freedom that Christ offers. Breaking news, extra, extra, read all about it. The hamburger is responsible for tearing the fabric of human society, or so said an Italian cleric. Hamburgers may be an American icon, but in Italy, a Catholic priest in Tuscany is suggesting that the road to hell is paved with hamburgers. Adding grease to the fire, he argues that hamburgers, French fries, and Coke are the fruit of a Protestant culture. In the fall of 2020, a full-page interview published in the Catholic daily newspaper Avvenire, Reverend Massimo Salani said, "Fast food reflects the individualistic relation between man and God." He insisted that fast food lacks the community aspect of sharing. Italians were deeply divided over the arrival of McDonald's hamburgers and other fast food chains in a country that takes its three-hour lunches almost as seriously as soccer. Of course, many other newspapers jumped on the bandwagon, and one newspaper in particular, the Rome Daily, El Messaggero, said in the front page, "Theologian excommunicates the hamburger." Perhaps the priest is right. We prefer bad food because, as we've so often observed, bad food tends or seems to taste better than good food. Better to wolf down a supersized quarter pounder with fries and Coke and enjoy it than to pick at a tofu salad and hate it. Of course, if you're a tofu lover, you've got the best of both worlds. Good food and good food you love. The Apostle Paul couldn't have expressed the dilemma better. He warns us that certain behaviors may cause the flesh to feel good, but they're ultimately destructive. Paul's bad food, fast food menu includes idolatry, sorcery, jealousy, anger, drunkenness. Would you like some fries to go with that? This is not the nourishment that God wants us to take in. Live by the Spirit, says Paul, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. Paul offers an alternative lifestyle option, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is slow food, not fast food. Good food, not bad food. It's a lifestyle that takes time to cultivate and to develop. We'll need to cultivate and nurture spiritual gifts, such as kindness and generosity. These fruits won't sprout out quickly, and they won't be ripe and ready overnight. Selecting the slow food fruit option allows us, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to gain control over how fast we go, to set a pace that enables us to cultivate and to nurture virtues such as love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and goodness. Kindness is an eagerness to put others at ease. It is a sweet and attractive temperament that shows friendly regard. There are many scriptural references, both in the Old and in the New Testament, but I chose to bring Jeremiah 9, and it says this: "Let not the wise person boast of their wisdom, or the strong person boast of their strength, or the rich person boast of their wealth. But let them who boast, boast about this, that they understand and know me, that I am the Lord, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." Goodness. Goodness is the selfless desire to be open-hearted and generous to others above what they deserve. Galatians 6, verses 9 and 10 says, "Let us not be weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." Kindness and goodness, fruit of the Spirit. We get to choose. We get to initiate sharing and inviting, giving the kindness and the goodness. We choose when and to who. Sometimes we happen to do it more often with those that we do not know. We are more ready to share kindness and goodness to the strangers at the gasoline station, at the grocery store, on the street. Why is that? We don't know their lifestyle. They don't know ours. They have never crossed our path. And more importantly, they have never disagreed with us. It is harder. It is more challenging to choose to give kindness and goodness to those in our household, to our family, to our friends who we know and have known for a long time. It is also challenging and difficult to share and to give freely kindness and goodness to the members of our congregation, because we know them and we still remember how they crossed my path and they said the wrong words at the wrong time. So I am entitled, aren't I? Do I not get to determine who is deserving of my kindness and my goodness that I'm going to offer? I do remember what you said. That's just it. Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 and 10 says, "Let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." There's a principle in the New Testament that God introduces to us, that we would begin to model our faith, that we would begin to model our Christian living first with the household of faith, with our home, with our friends, with our family. This is where it gets challenging, because sometimes we just keep things inside of us instead of releasing them and letting them go. But the beautiful thing about Paul's encouragement to the Galatians, even in the midst of them being confused and being sabotaged by Paul's words of encouragement, the Judaizers kept saying, no, none of that is true. You first have to do this. First, you become circumcised. Paul says that that was not the intent of the purpose of Christ's death and resurrection, but that after we have come to terms and acknowledge that Christ is our Lord and our Savior, we now have freedom in Christ. We are free to give. We are free to let go. We are free to forget. Kindness and goodness is already in us. It's a part of the fruit of the Spirit that is already inside of you and me. And Paul encourages us that it's going to take time to cultivate and to continue to promote this gift, even for those who we qualify that perhaps are not deserving enough. The art of Christian living, choosing a slow faith rather than a fast faith approach to living, also requires community. Christianity is based on a shared communion meal and life together in the body of Christ, not on fast faith pit stops and individualistic approaches to the Christian life. It is within the community that Paul challenges us to become slaves to one another through love, resisting the temptation to use our Christian freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence. It's like the Italian theologian said, fast food lacks the community aspect of sharing. Fast faith is as deficient as fast food, an approach to Christianity that is rushed and individualistic. Those in the Spirit are all those who live the light of Christ's redemptive acts. To live in the Spirit is to experience the crucifixion of one's own flesh, and thus to enjoy the new freedom that Christ offers. Church, God is calling us to make a lifestyle change. Amen. Please, as you are comfortable, stand to your feet and join us as we sing, Great is the Lord.
Great is the Lord, He is holy and just, by His power we trust in His love. Great is the Lord, He is faithful and true, by His mercy He proves He is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory, great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice, we lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of glory. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of praise. Great are you, Lord, I lift up my voice, I lift up my voice. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Please be seated. I told Daniel after I heard that sermon the first time this morning, I'm going to be thinking about hamburgers all day long. Such a compelling image, isn't it? Join your hearts with mine in prayer. Oh God, we give you thanks for your constant presence in our lives, for your steadfast love that never gives up. We thank you today, especially for these seeds of the fruit of the Spirit that you have implanted in us as we came to believe in your Son and to receive his goodness and grace. We know that it's our work to grow those seeds into full-fledged fruit. But it would be so nice to have patience now, and joy now, and peace now. And yet you have given us this great honor and privilege of collaborating with you in that work in us. So help us to choose well, Lord. Especially in this season where people are not making very good choices, or so it seems, when there's a lot of throwing of words around that are hurtful and harmful, when there's a lot of accusations and when it's hard to discern the truth, especially in this season, Lord, help us to choose well. To choose love, to choose joy, to choose peace, to choose each one of these fruit of the Spirit, so that we might be a living witness of your love in the world. You know, the Lord, that the burdens that we brought in the door today, so many things are on our hearts and minds. People who we know who need a touch of your hand, perhaps today it is one of us that needs a touch of your hand. Needs healing, needs hope, needs possibility, needs direction, Lord. In this moment of silence, we name those concerns that came in with us. We name them before you. We lift them up and we surrender them to your care. We thank you, Lord, for hearing every prayer, for caring for each person who prays, and for all of those for whom we pray. And we thank you that you allow us to make a difference in far places simply by lifting a prayer. There are so many people today who need a touch of your grace. In the wake of a terrible hurricane, flooding and loss of power and loss of life and loss of homes and loss of security are being experienced by so many people. Lord, we lift all of those who have been affected by this hurricane, and we lift them up into the light and life of your love, and we surrender them to your care. Bring to them the things that they need to move through these days when their homes may have been destroyed and they may have lost a loved one. Bring them the resources that they need to recover. And if there is some way we can be one of those resources, Lord, then move in our hearts to make us willing to share our bounty with those who have lost so much. We pray for the people of this community around us that as we walk among them, they might experience a little touch of your grace and love and be changed forever by those small encounters. And we pray for this church that we might be a place where we learn to exhibit all of these wonderful fruit that you have given to us, so that your love, your joy, your peace is felt in the world in a wonderful way. Make us a beacon of your hope and light, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Make my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
Every week we highlight a ministry of our church so you know where your financial gifts are being used. And we are featuring today the ministry of United Women in Faith. They are resuming their fall programming, and you can sign up today for their lunch next week. United Women in Faith was started in Boston in 1869 by six women who wanted to help women in India who were denied treatment by male doctors and who were not able to get an education. Their efforts over a few years allowed them to send both a female doctor and a female missionary. Today, United Women in Faith supports a missionary work locally, nationally, and internationally. They are a community of women whose purpose is to know God and to experience freedom as whole persons through Jesus Christ, to develop a creative, supportive fellowship, and to expand concepts of mission through the global ministry of the church. All women of the church are welcome to join this group for monthly luncheons, normally held on the first Thursday of each month, October through May. There are two circles. Miriam Circle meets 1 o'clock on the fourth Wednesday of each month, and Rebecca Circle meets at 2 on the third Monday of the month. UWF is a separate and self-supporting organization mandated by the discipline of the United Methodist Church. Every local Methodist church has one. And here we are lucky to have a very active group. We thank you for your gifts, which provide the framework for all of this wonderful ministry. Hospitable meeting spaces, a kitchen, advertising, all of the comforts needed for mission and ministry. Their ministry touches many lives here and beyond. And that means that you are always touching more lives than you realize. Your gifts may be placed in the offering boxes that are next to each door as you exit. And I invite you now to rise as you are comfortable to join me in our song of praise.
Standing as you are comfortable and join me in prayer. Receive our humble offerings, O Lord, for your work in the world. Bless those who give, those who send, and those who will receive these gifts. May the offerings sow seeds of hope and bear the fruit of kindness and goodness wherever they are sown. And now we pray the Lord that the Lord has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'd like to remind those who are in the group that the Bell Choir will begin rehearsals this Friday at 10 o'clock. In addition, if there are those in the congregation who would like to join us in singing the cantata this year, we will begin on Friday rehearsing that at 2 o'clock. So we'll do all the anthems at 1 and the cantata begins at 2 o'clock. I'm looking at you, Dave Gentry. And anyone else, you're warmly invited to come and join us. Now, please remain standing as we sing our closing hymn, My Hope is Built.
I can't believe you guys were not able to hear us. We were, the three of us up here, top-notch singing. We did it. Thank you so much for coming. If you are a first-time visitor with us, thank you for choosing to spend time in worship with us. And please stop by at the Welcome Center right out these doors in the center and see Jenny. There are many opportunities listed in your announcement, so take a moment to check them out. Just a few that I would like to highlight, though. Due to staff absences, the church office will be open from 8:30 to 2:30 p.m. Monday through Thursday and closed on Fridays until October the 7th. For access at other times, please make an appointment with the pastor or staff you need to see. On Wednesday at 1 p.m., join us to hear a speaker who will address the changes coming in Medicare for 2025. It would really help us if you sign up for this, so that way we know how many people will be in attendance. Next Saturday at 9:30 a.m., bring your furry friends and join us for a blessing of the animals. Pass the word to your pet-loving friends and invite them to come along. And lastly, sign up today for pumpkin decorating next week during fellowship hour. We just need to know how many pumpkins to buy. Our prayer minister is already available in the prayer corner for those that would be wanting to come and share a few moments in individual prayer. And of course, our communion is ready to be offered here in front following the service. Join us in the fellowship hall for a time of coffee and conversation following the service. And remember, choose kindness and goodness. And now receive the blessing. As we leave these doors of this building, we enter into the mission field. May the Holy Spirit lead us, guide us, and bring unto us opportunities to be able to give kindness and goodness. And may we also experience kindness and goodness as we continue to establish the kingdom of God in this place. Be blessed. Amen.